My parents, and I don't know if you'd believe this, but this is only half my family. So there's another four of us around here somewhere. But we're going to continue to sing. So go ahead and stand with us. We're going to read Revelation 4.
Revelation 4, 1 through 11. After this I looked, and there in heaven was an open door. The first voice that I had heard speaking to me like a trumpet said, "Come up here, and I will show you what must take place after this." Immediately I was in the Spirit, and there was a throne in heaven, and someone was seated on it.
The one seated there had the appearance of jasper and carnelian stone. A rainbow that had the appearance of an emerald surrounded the throne. Around the throne were 24 thrones, and on the throne sat 24 elders dressed in white clothes with golden crowns on their heads.
Flashes of lightning and rumblings and peals of thunder came from the throne. Seven fiery torches were burning before the throne, which are the seven spirits of God. Something like a sea of glass, similar to crystal, was also before the throne. Four living creatures, covered with eyes in front and in back, were around the throne on each side.
The first living creature was like a lion, and the second living creature was like an ox. The third living creature had a face like a man, and the fourth living creature was like a flying eagle. Each of the four living creatures had six wings, and they were covered with eyes around and inside. Day and night they never stopped saying, "Holy, holy, holy, Lord God the Almighty, who was, who is, and who is to come."
Whenever the living creatures give glory, honor, and thanks to the one seated on the throne, the one who lives forever and ever, the 24 elders fall down before the one seated on the throne and worship the one who lives forever and ever. They cast their crowns before the throne and say, "Our Lord and God, you are worthy to receive glory and honor and power, because you have created all things, and by your will they exist and were created."
Thank you. majesty before my eyes. I'll let it take my breath away. A million angels fall, face down on the floor, all to echo, holy is the Lord. My heart can't help but sing with all of heaven roar, forever echo, holy is the Lord. A million angels fall, face down on the floor, all to echo,
good morning. Good to see you guys. Good to worship with you. I love that song, Echo Holy. We're going to be singing that, I assume, because when you read about the throne room, you read about that. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. So we probably ought to get used to singing it now, right?
Amen.
God is holy. He is set apart. There is none like him. And that's what we acknowledge in that. So a couple things that are coming up. One, next week is Easter, and I know that some of these announcements have already been made, but we are planning to have a baptism. I have one person who's confirmed that wants to get baptized, which is great. Excited. I love having baptisms on Easter. So if you have never been baptized and you want to get baptized, if you're like, hey, I've made a declaration of faith in Christ, but I've never gone public with that, then I'd love to talk to you this week. Great, we'd love to be part of that. So I'm just putting that out there. We'll have another one coming up because I have a couple more that want to get baptized in May, and so I know there's some coming down the road as well, but love to be able to dunk you under the water, all right? So it's a fun time. No, it's a good time to be able to make that declaration of faith in Christ. So again, just want to extend that. Please come talk to me. Don't just show up expecting to be baptized. Talk, because we want to go over some things, make sure that we're doing this the right way. So come talk to me if you'd like to get baptized after our Easter service. We are having Easter next week at Sherman Elementary, so I know that, again, that announcement has been made, but sometimes you got to announce it more than once for it to kind of sink in, right? So, but a couple other things I just want to let you know about. One is that when we've done this in the past, where we've done some of our Easter services, we've been doing these outside for the last 3 or 4 years, can't remember. And every year we've had great weather and all that. This year it's like, well, it's pretty early. And this year's weather has been pretty questionable, so we're going to go ahead and do it inside. But we want to run it a lot like we would run it at the park. And so if you come, and I'm hoping and praying that you come and you invite some people, but what you can expect is that we'll go to the school, you'll see an area, we'll have signs and all that kind of stuff out, but you'll see an area where you can come and you can park and then come out, and then we'll be serving food, most likely outside, unless the weather is just terrible. And then we'll go into the gymnasium, and in there we'll have tables and chairs and all that kind of set up. Now, we're not going to, like, after breakfast, break everything down and reset the whole room. We're just going to kind of leave it that way. It's just going to be a family service. It's a family celebration. So, again, if you've gone outside service, it's going to be very much the same way. Sometimes you guys bring lawn chairs. This time you don't have to, unless you really want a lawn chair in there. But you'll be one of the weird ones if you do. Just to let you know, all right?
But if you want to, and that's more comfortable, go for it. So that's kind of the setting. It'll be, we'll have, the only thing we'll have for kids is we're going to have the nursery area set up. And so it's kind of a man-your-own nursery is what it would be. So if you feel like, oh, I just need to take a break for a little while, go out somewhere, that'll be set up for you. But really, it'll just be set up for a family service. So that's what's happening on Easter. Easter is about the celebration of Jesus Christ, right? And so Good Friday is kind of similar, but we're going to talk about the death of Christ. We're not going to talk about the resurrection because that happens 3 days later. And so then we'll celebrate together what Christ has done. And so really it is a big kind of family event. The week after that, we'll have our regular services there at Sherman again, but we'll have kids' services running at that point. And that's going to look a little bit different, but I'm going to talk about that later on in the service. So we are continuing our theme under him this summer, or this year, not summer. We haven't hit summer yet. This year, and part of that, as we think through the next several weeks and even months, I want to take this theme of under him and go into just looking at his provision and call this message, I guess, under his provision. God has provided for us, and it's great to be reminded of that. So this is Palm Sunday, and you might know what Palm Sunday is. I'm just going to briefly state that. I'm not going to give a message about Palm Sunday, but that's the day where Jesus rides into Jerusalem, and people are saying, Hosanna, Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, and they're praising him, and they're worshiping him, and then 5 days later, they're saying, crucify him. That's how fickle, you know, we are sometimes as people. That's how easily we can be led from one direction to another and all that kind of stuff. And unfortunately, that's what happens, and that's what did happen. Now, that was a blessing because his death, his burial, resulted in the resurrection of Christ, and that's what gives us eternal life. He paid the price of sin. Sin was poured out upon him, and so we're grateful for all that. So we want to look at that as well this week, and we're going to be doing that on Good Friday, his death, and then we're going to be celebrating the resurrection on Sunday. So that's what's happening this week, but as we also in the life of the church, as we think about those events, we're thinking about the event of moving from this location to another location in the future and what that holds for us. So there are some great memories in this place. Maybe you've been here all along the way. Maybe you were with us the day we planted Involve Church. Maybe you came somewhere along the way and you met with us when we were over at Snake River Elementary. Maybe this the first time you've ever been to Involve Church was here in this building. So I'll take a trip down memory lane a little bit. And for some of you who remember this place, before we showed up here, we invited the members of the church to come together and any attender that wanted to be part of it. And we said, hey, there's a church building. Would you like to come take a look at it? We're thinking about purchasing it. And so at the time, we were renting a downtown office area called the Underground. Some of you might remember that. My greatest memory of the Underground is that is the place we had the first Involve live streaming. It was terrible. But we did it through Facebook. It was during the Snowmageddon times, and you know, very few people could get there, and we had a phone set up. I mean, it was, you know, those beautiful days. But we learned a lot through it. It was a teaching moment, and it was good memories, so it was fun there. But we did that while we were also meeting at Snake River Elementary at the time. Well, as time went by, this building came available, and we looked at it, and at first we were like, nah, let's not go there. And eventually we said, hey, it has a residence that's built onto it, and we were looking at doing more church planting, and we thought that would be a great opportunity for us to do a residency church planting program. And it has office space, or we can make office space out of it. And so we bought the place, thinking we're going to do a residency program, thinking we're going to have it for offices, training, and so we called it the Involve Training Center. You might hear us talk about it at times as the ITC, the Involve Training Center. That was the original intent. We didn't intend to meet here on Sunday mornings. But through COVID, we ended up meeting here, and we put down some roots here. And so that started happening. We worked on the building. We walked through here. The first time we walked through here with some members, I remember people looking around, and the ceiling was white, but it wasn't really white because it was black. But it was supposed to be white, and the walls had cracks in them and all that kind of stuff. And I remember one lady looking around going, is this building safe? Like, should we have kids running around in here? And so that was kind of the beginning, and downstairs it's completely transformed downstairs. But those are some of the things that we walked through, and a lot of people thought, honestly, we were crazy at the time. But we bought it, and we used it, and it was good timing, because shortly after, God opened the doors for us to meet here at the time. And so we were blessed by that, and you know, we ended up doing two services, and I remember going from one service to two service, and the first service, there was like, you know, five or six people at times that would show up, and we would have that as a family service, and we'd have kids' songs, and Rebecca would be up here singing and leading with motions, and you saw a bunch of adults trying to do these kids' songs. It was pretty funny. But it was great times, great memories, right? And God used it and blessed it, and it became a tool for the gospel. And we appreciate and recognize that. So I think we ought to praise God for that. But we don't have to feel like we have to stay here if God continues to open up some doors. And so I think that's kind of where we're at, and that's what we're looking at as we go move forward. The Lord provided. And so I want to take a look at a story in the Old Testament where God provides and where we get the name, maybe you've heard the name Jehovah Jireh, somewhere along the way as a name of God or a title of God even. That's a King James translation, Jehovah Jireh, and I won't go into all the details of it, but if you were to say it actually as it would have been said in their language, it would have been Yahweh Jireh instead. But the idea is that God will provide. And that's the name, that's the title, and it comes from this story of Abraham. And you might be familiar with the story of Abraham. He was the first of Israel, the father of Israel. He was the first one that God gave that covenant with and said, I will make you into many people, into a nation of many people. He left Ur, his hometown, when he was 75, which, you know, is a pretty good age to finally leave home, right? 75, when he left his hometown, God called him out and said, you need to go to the place that I'm going to send you to. And so he went out, and he was promised a descendant. He was promised a child. But he waited 25 years for that promise to be fulfilled. So you can imagine, he's already 75, and he didn't have a child at this point. He and his wife, Sarah. And so they go out, and as they're going, they're probably thinking to themselves, when are we going to start having, you know, kids? We're getting kind of older. And eventually they stepped in on their own and they said, hey, we're going to speed this process up. And that's when they actually had Ishmael, which became a mistake for them down the road. But God had a plan that he was going to give them that promised child. He had to wait 25 years before God shows up. He was 99 at the time, and God said, hey, you're going to have a child next year. And at first, you can read about the story in Genesis chapter 17. At first, Abraham laughed, and then Sarah laughed as well. They both laughed at the idea, like, what? We're going to have kids at this age? But they did, and they had Isaac. And then, sometime later, and this is, we're not exactly sure, maybe 15 years, some have even estimated up to 20 years later, Abraham was asked to sacrifice his promised child. Well, that would be hard, you know. You've waited 25 years, and now God comes and says, Abraham, I want you to go and sacrifice your child. And so I want to read that part of the story. There's your backstory leading into it. Now, listen to this portion of Scripture, Genesis 22, 1 through 14. It says, after these things, God tested Abraham and said to him, Abraham, here I am, he answered. Take your son, he said, your only son, Isaac. He didn't mention Ishmael. He said, your only son, Isaac, that's the promised one, whom you love, and go to the land of Moriah and offer him there as a burnt offering. One of the mountains I will tell you about. So Abraham got up early in the morning. Most of us would probably push that off, right? Like, let's wait a little longer. Abraham got up early in the morning, saddled his donkey, and took with him two of his young men and his son Isaac. And he split wood for a burnt offering and set out to go to the place God had told him about. Now on the third day, the Bible's interesting that way. It likes to use things like 40 and third day. On the third day, Abraham looked up and saw the place in the distance. Then Abraham said to his young men, stay here with the donkey. The boy and I will go over there to worship. Then we'll come back to you. And Abraham took the wood for the burnt offering and laid it on his son Isaac. Kind of an indication of how old Isaac was. Split wood on his back. Abraham didn't carry it. His son carries it. so old enough to carry split wood up a hill. In his hand, then, Abraham took the fire and the knife, and the two of them walked on together. Then Isaac spoke to his father Abraham and said, "My father." And he replied, "Here I am, my son." Isaac said, "The fire and the wood are here, but where is the lamb for the burnt offering?" Abraham answered, "God himself will provide the lamb for the burnt offering, my son." It's a nice way to not answer the question, right? Then the two of them walked on together. And when they arrived at the place that God had told him about, Abraham built the altar there and arranged the wood, and he bound his son Isaac. Remember the one that just carried the wood up, probably stronger than his 115-year-old, 120-year-old dad at the time? Somehow he binds his son Isaac. Isaac agrees to it, maybe. He placed him on the altar on top of the wood. Then Abraham reached out and took the knife to slaughter his son, but the angel of the Lord called to him from heaven and said, "Abraham, Abraham." He replied, "Here I am." Then he said, "Do not lay a hand on the boy or do anything to him, for now I know that you fear God, since you have not withheld your only son from me." Abraham looked up and saw a ram caught in the thicket by its horns. So Abraham went and took the ram and offered it as a burnt offering in the place of his son. And Abraham named that place, "The Lord will provide," Yahweh Yireh. So today it is said it'll be provided on the Lord's mountain. That's an interesting phrase in a couple different ways. One, you see the Lord will provide, and you've heard that that's the name of God. And truly, I think that is the case here. But interestingly enough, it's talking about the place. It's the name of the place that's called "The Lord will provide." And furthermore, he goes on, he says, it will be provided on the Lord's mountain. It's kind of termed that, the Lord's mountain. This is a special place. It's a place that God appointed, and it's become a special place. In the story, Abraham trusted God, who called him out of Ur when he was 75 and told him he was going to have a child, waited 25 years, and then another 15 years or so goes by. He's told to go and sacrifice his son now on this mountain that God points him to. And when he gets there, he tells his two servants that had gone with them, "We're going to go up to the mountain, and we are going to return. We'll return. We will return," he says, talking about him and his son. And the author of Hebrews picks up on that. Look at what it says. It's by faith Abraham, when he was tested, offered up Isaac. He received the promises, and yet he was offering his one and only son, the one to whom it had been said, "Your offspring will be traced through Isaac." And he considered God to be able even to raise someone from the dead. Therefore, he received him back, figuratively speaking. You see, God said it would be through Isaac. So it wasn't like Abraham's like, "Well, if I kill Isaac, God will give me another son." No, God said it's going to be through him. And so when he says go and slaughter his son, or go and sacrifice his son, or anything like that, he's like, "Okay, I'm going to go do that." But somehow God's going to fulfill his promise. He had that kind of faith. I don't know that I have that kind of faith. I mean, that's pretty tremendous. But Abraham did. That place became known as "The Lord will provide," and "The Lord will continue to provide." This is the place today. It has an interesting history. It's called the Dome of the Rock. The Muslims have placed a temple on top of it. It is a place that Israel would love to have back, will try to have back, has plans to have back, wants to build a temple on it. They are moving forward and will try to do that in the future for sure. A little bit of the history. King Solomon built the temple on this mount. You can read about it in 2 Corinthians chapter 3. It says he built it on the mount at Moriah. King Herod, after King Solomon had been destroyed, King Herod comes and rebuilds the temple on this mount. Jesus teaches here. A lot of his teachings happened here. Jesus died near this mount, and he ascended near the mount. This is an aerial picture of it, and it's a little bit hard to see, but you can see right there in the middle, that's where the Dome of the Rock is today. Golgotha, most likely, most agree it's over in this area, and Jesus ascended into heaven on the Mount of Olives, somewhere over in this area. Either place, he actually would have had a view of that mount. Now, maybe his back would have been turned, depending on how he was crucified there. But either place, he would have been close to it. Pentecost, which is when the Holy Spirit comes to the church, and you read about it in Acts chapter 2, happened near this area. We don't know exactly where, but near this area. In the future, we know Jesus went up on the Mount of Olives and the Ascension, and we're told in Acts chapter 1, verse 11, that he's going to come back the same way. I think he's going to come back that spot. There's no reason not to believe that. I mean, everything seems to happen here. And it's kind of interesting because today in a lot of theology, and I think we need to be careful with it, a lot of theology, and I should have put a picture of it, but I think a lot of people think that the future prophecy has more to do with the White House than it does with this spot. And that's just not true. It has to do with this place. In fact, I often tell people when they're saying, what do you think about prophecy in the future? What do you think about end times? I'm like, watch this spot where the Lord will provide. Now, I've been there. I've visited it. I'll be honest with you. There are a lot more beautiful places on the earth. But to the Lord, this is a beautiful place. For whatever reason. It's his spot. In fact, even in the future, Revelation 21, it says, then, this is John, then I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. I also saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared like a bride adorned for her husband. Again, I don't see any reason why not to believe it's going to be in that spot. God has his heart set on it. That's where he has spent a lot of prophecy. That's where a lot of things have happened. And it goes back to that story. The Lord will provide. Now, that's for Israel. And I think that God has a plan for Israel's future and all of that. So I think there is something to be said there. We're not Israel. We're the church. We're made up of Jews and Gentiles and all of that. I think we support what's happening. We ought to be behind it and all that kind of stuff. But we're here in Nampa, Idaho, right? And so our story is a little bit different. So let's take a look at what we do know with the Lord providing. Abraham knew that God would provide. Israel believed it. We celebrate it because in that spot, Jesus Christ died on the cross and rose from the dead, or nearby that spot, and we celebrate that. And we believe it has a future. God provides. But what about today? What about today? And what about involve and where we're at today and what we're doing in the future? So here are some things that we know that God has told us. And we believe the same God that provides on that spot in that location over the years and in the future will provide even now. And so we're told some of these things. He loves us more than birds and flowers. Matthew chapter 6 says, consider the birds of the sky. Now, they don't sow or reap or gather into barns, yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Aren't you worth more than they? Can any of you add one moment to his lifespan by worrying? And why do you worry about clothes? Observe how the wildflowers of the fields grow. They don't labor or spin thread, yet I tell you that not even Solomon in all of his splendor was adorned like one of these. And if that's how God clothes the grass of the field, which is here today and thrown into the furnace tomorrow, won't he do much more for you, you of little faith? I mean, God loves the birds, he loves the flowers, and he takes care of them. Just trust him. Trust him. He provides. Abraham had to learn to do that, and he was tested. His faith was tested. Now, our faith, I think, gets tested at times. Do we trust God with those things, the decisions? Are we faithful to him in the midst of adversity and difficulties? When he gives those tests, those trials, are we continuing to be faithful to him in the midst of them? He loves you. He loves us. And he is the head of the church. So one of the other things we see in Scripture, we see this over and over. We're going to talk about it more when we get into April, about what it means to be under him. And this is one of the passages we'll be taking a look at in more detail, Ephesians chapter 1. Verse 22, it says, and he subjected everything, the he there being God the Father, subjected everything under his, Jesus' feet, and appointed him, Jesus, as head over everything for the church. It's his church. Now think about that. If this is his church, and he loves us more than the birds of the air and the flowers of the field, don't you think he has a plan for it? Absolutely. So we can rest in that belief and that faith that we have in Jesus Christ. He's the head of the church. And we want to submit to him. And that's why we need to be praying. That's why we need to be seeking his desires, his wills, because it's him that's leading the church, hopefully. Now, I think sometimes we screw that up because we get ourselves in there. God has to teach us and humble us. But we want to be faithful to come before him and ask for his guidance and his direction. And number three, there is nothing to fear with God in control. Brett had preached on this message a while back when we were going through 1 John. And I thought it was great just working through, talking through with them this, because it is a difficult passage in a lot of different ways. But verse 18, it says, there's no fear in love. Well, if you go back a few verses, it says, God is love. And I love how if you just, you can actually swap the words out. There is no fear in God. In other words, God doesn't have any fear. Instead, perfect love, our perfect God, drives out fear. Because fear involves punishment. So the one who fears is not complete in love or complete in God. It's not mature, and that's the idea of mature and growth in him. There's nothing to fear when God's in charge, is there? And that's had to have been the confidence that Abraham had as he walked up on that mountain with his son. I'm sure he was shaken. I'm sure he was nervous. I'm sure he was had an ounce of fear, you know, in him. But he had the confidence that God would fulfill his promise. There's nothing to fear with God in control. The question should never be, will God provide, right? I think sometimes we might have that question. Well, will God provide? The question really needs to be, what will God provide? We know God will provide something. We might just be asking the question, what? Now, we may not find out until he reveals it, and that's okay. Those who wait on the Lord will renew their strength. We'll wait, we'll see what he has for us, and we'll enjoy it. Just like I think this building for us as a church was one of those tools that God gave us. And we didn't expect it. We didn't know what he's going to do with it. We didn't know COVID was around the corner. But he used it. And we were blessed by it because that's the kind of God we have. So he takes care of us and we can rest in his care. The big idea for you, or a big idea I have for you today is this. The time has come to trust God on this new adventure. And it is a new adventure. And so some of you know me enough to know that I can be a little adventurous in this area. So I'll give you a little bit of the story of how at least I got to this point as a pastor and how involved kind of got here. And maybe some of this will make a little more sense to you. Because I'll be honest with you, some churches, the idea of moving, in fact, I've even shared that with some churches and pastors. Yeah, we're moving now. We're going to go back to a school. And people are like, How does your church take that? Well, so far, I think they've taken it okay. I mean, I don't know. We'll find out next week, maybe. But I think they're taking it okay. But I mean, people get in a building, and that becomes church to them. But that's not what church is it? I mean, if this building is what you're in love with, as far as the church goes, then it's the wrong focus. Because we ought to care about and love the people, not the building. So back when Rebecca and I were newlyweds, before actually Emily was even born, I was at seminary and I was taking classes and we were in a church that was on the decline. They had gone through a transition and stuff and we could see it. We could see the future. We could see that there was probably not much of a future for us there. I was an associate pastor, and so as I was in seminary, we had somebody come and visit and say, hey, we'd like to plant this church down in this town called Tenino, Washington. And they said, we would like it if, you know, somebody wanted to come and teach and be our pastor. And I was like, that'd be interesting. I'll check into it. And so I did, and we went down there, and we talked to this guy that was down there. And I remember there's probably like five people in the area, and he was starting in the basement of his church. And it was like probably one of those situations that wasn't really ideal. And we still said, yeah, let's do it. So it was 2.5 hours from where we lived. On a Sunday morning, we would get up in the morning. We'd drive 2.5 hours down there. Rebecca was pregnant with Emily. And then we would We would run church, we would grab something to eat, and we would drive back 2.5 hours. Like, that was our Sunday for a while. And that tells you a little bit about my wife, what she's gone through in life, right? And I don't know, I think she probably missed the one Sunday after Emily was born. That was about it. I mean, she was a trooper the whole time. And so we went through that, and through just a series of events, we did a vacation Bible school there. And the church got, I mean, there were times where like 3 people were there. There were times there when there was like 25 people there. You know, we're preaching and teaching, and we're trying to do some discipleship and all that kind of stuff. And there were some things that happened, and we're like, okay, this probably isn't the right place. And so we ended up, I think after, I don't know, 9 months or so, ended up not going there. And I got a position at another church in the Seattle area. And so we finished seminary, went to that church for quite a while, and then God opened up an opportunity to go to this place called Kathlamet, Washington. And some of you have probably heard of me mention that somewhere along the ways, but Kathlamet is down on the Columbia River. And it's about 30 miles from the mouth of the Columbia. And if you've been in that area, you know as the Columbia River opens up, it's really wide, it's very large. It actually is affected by the tides at that point and all that kind of stuff. And so in some ways, you're kind of part of the ocean at that point. And in that portion of the river, there's a lot of islands. And so we were on this one called Puget Island. There's a bridge that comes over from the Washington side, and on the Oregon side, there's a ferry that goes across. That's where the ship channel is, and so you can watch the big ships come up and down, and all kinds of fishing and all kinds of stuff down there in that area. And so we moved down there. I don't eat fish. I don't like fish, but I was like, well, we're going to go there anyhow. We went to this church down there that was small. There was, again, about 12 people. And they asked us, the first time we were down there, like, oh, you should come be our pastor. And I was like, I don't know. Let's do this the official way. And so we went through the whole process of candidating and everything. And they called us to come down there. So we packed up our family, and we moved down to this little island in Kathlamet. And I remember the first year, you know, we started doing some ministry, and we moved down there in November of 2005. And January 2006, I don't know if you remember here what was happening here in 2006, but I think it was a good snow year, but then it got warm really fast. And I think they call it the Pineapple Express or something like that, where the water starts to melt really quickly, and it floods the rivers. And so here we are. We're where all of that water exits out into the ocean, right? And we're there. The first year we're there, 3 months that we've been there. And we're watching the river rise, and it was the same time that the tides were high. And so whenever those two things happen, the river just starts to go. And we were in an area where the river would come over the bank. And this, you know, happened all the time. All the locals are like, don't worry about it. It happens all the time. But we're new. I'm from Idaho for the most part. I mean, water to me is just the canals turn on and off, and that's the water you see, right? And you have a little more control. But here, it's like the water's just building and building, and we're standing there, and I'm literally like, if this is the floor to the house we're staying in, the water, I felt like I'm standing on the water. It got up so high. In fact, there are places in the house where the water was starting to come through the floorboards. So I'm calling people on the church. I'm like, is this normal? Yeah, it's normal. Don't worry about it. Are you sure about that? And sure enough, I'm watching the time. I'm looking at the tide. I'm like, okay, the tide's supposed to go down. And it would. It would go down. And I remember at one point turning to Rebecca. I was like, what did we do? This is crazy. So we ended up buying a house on the mainland. We got off the islands, but the church was still there. And we did ministry there for many years, 9 years we were down in that area. And God blessed it. I mean, it was a great time. It was a great time. My kids enjoyed, I think, growing up there and all that kind of stuff, at least the ones that did grow up there. And eventually we had to tell them, hey, God's moving us to a different place. And so those would usually include a family meeting. I don't know if you guys had family meetings, but those would include a family meeting, so we sit down and say, hey, this is what the Lord's doing. Mom and I have been praying about this, and we're moving to Idaho, which was hard at the beginning. And so we walked through all of that with them, and we packed the bags, and we left, and we came here to Idaho, not knowing if we were going to be in a church. We believed God wanted us to plant a church, but we didn't know exactly what that was going to look like at the time. So I started working with a friend of mine who's a farmer and did farming for a couple years while we were planning and starting the church. So that was kind of our transition here to involve. All of those, I guess, ways are probably not a normal way for some pastors, but it's the way that God provided for me. And so one of the reasons I tell you that is because I think it's important for you to know the kind of pastor you have, because you might be like, some of these ideas are kind of crazy. But it's what God puts in front of us. And through all of those things, God has shown himself, I will say to us and to our family, to be faithful. And he has provided all along the ways. And so there might be times where it just feels uncomfortable. It might feel like, you know what, I don't know about this. I don't know if it's a good move. I don't know what's going to happen. And in some ways, kind of like I do with my kids, this is a family meeting to just say, I think God's got this. We can trust him. You know, it's just, it's a small move for us, maybe. But what's, in the days ahead is a little bit uncertain, but God's got it. And there might be some bumps along the way, but that's okay. He knows. And we just got to trust him through it. And he takes care of us. And so I want to give you that confidence. I want to give you that assurance that the time has come to trust God on this new adventure. And it may feel like it's difficult at times. It may feel a little uncomfortable. There might be times where you're like, I really like the time we had at ITC or, you know, whatever, but it's going to be all right. God's got it. And we can trust him in all of it. So here's some things I wanted to share with you on what we should expect in the coming weeks. One is we're going to be down to one service. Now, there's several people that are like really excited about one service, and I am too. I mean, there's an advantage to obviously having one service. One of the downsides, and this is one I just want to acknowledge because I think that there's some of you that will feel this more than others, and that is one of the beauties of having two services is for our children's workers. Oftentimes, they don't get an opportunity to go to a service. And so when you have two services, they can come and serve, and then they can still come and worship and celebrate the Lord in another service. We try to do our best to have rotation so people have that opportunity to come and worship the Lord. But sometimes it's 50% of the month. So a lot of the times they can't make it. Now, I know that's kind of dear to me because I've been married to a woman who's done children's ministry all of her life. And so I know that she's probably not had a lot of services where she can come and worship at. But she has been able to enjoy that, with two services. So there is, on one hand, I know there's a lot of reason to celebrate the one service idea, and I like that. But I also want you to know, if you're a children's worker, that that's important to us, that, you get that time to come and worship with your church family. And so take advantage of that when you have that opportunity. Kids are going to be starting in the service with us. And so we're going to make this transition. It's going to be a little bit different. They'll be there, they'll be singing with us, and then we'll dismiss them to go and do the kids' ministry. And so that's going to look a little bit different. Again, next week is completely different. We're all going to be together the whole time. The week after that, the first Sunday in April, we'll actually start everybody together. We'll have some details that'll go out about checking your kids in first, making sure they get their labels and all that kind of stuff, and then they'll be dismissed during the service. And so the kids team is going to be talking about that today, and so you guys will be aware of all of that and the details, and then we'll be able to hopefully fill in the parents and let them know what's going on. But the other thing we can expect is to make an impact for God's glory. That's what we really want to do, right? And whether that's here or there, God can do it anywhere. And so we just want to be faithful to serve him wherever he takes us. Well, what about the ITC, the Involved Training Center? That's a question that comes up. And so some of the things that we continue to use the ITC for: office space, youth, and weekly meetings. So youth ministry happens here in Sunday evening and other times as well. There's a life group that meets here. There's a couple other meetings that happen here, and so it'll continue to be used for that. It's also going to be continued to use for the residency program. We have a resident coming, a church planting resident that's going to be coming in July. His name's Garrett Munger. And the plan is for him to come here with his wife, Maddie, and go through an 18-month residency program and see what the Lord opens up with that. It could be that there's a church plant down the road from that and all that kind of stuff. And so we're excited about that opportunity. So that's the plan at this point, moving forward. And then El Tesoro, which is a church that meets here in the afternoon, likely they're probably going to bump their schedule around a little bit, and they might start meeting in the morning. But that's what will continue to happen here on Sunday. So the building gets used. A lot of people don't realize on Sunday, we show up here around 7:30 to 8 o'clock. We unlock the doors, and the doors don't lock again until 9 o'clock, I'd say, in the evening. There's this constant activity that happens on a Sunday. And then the rest of the week, there's a lot of different stuff that happens here as well. So it'll continue to get used. It's a tool that's not going to just get thrown in the the cupboard and closed up on. It'll get used plenty. So what do we need to do? What do we need? So one, we need your prayers. That's important. That's vital. We always need prayers. You can ramp it up a little bit. That's all right here too, okay? These things are important to the life of the church, and so we want to make sure we do things well. It's God's church, and we want to do it His way. So be praying all along the way. We need your help. Brett mentioned this earlier. Yesterday was awesome. If you were here and you were doing the coffee outreach, you got to see 75 different people. I think we counted up about 75 people that were volunteering here to make coffee. And it wasn't just making coffee. We had people putting bags together. We had people holding signs, which was really cool to watch. As a Baptist church or Baptistic church or whatever, Baptist pastor, if you want, you don't see people dancing often, but when you give them a sign on a street corner, I'm like, wow, they need a dance like ministry or something. I don't know. So it was kind of fun to watch. But they were having a great time, directing people over here. And then there were people over, just talking to those who would drive up and having some interaction. And so it was, for me, the best part is just sitting back watching it all happen. Like I had just one of those, is it right to be a proud, pastor at that point? But that's kind of what I felt like. At one point, I'm like sitting back, I'm like, oh, this is really cool to watch everybody working, the body of Christ working together. And so so that was really neat to be able to just witness that and see what God's doing. And so what I wanted to point out in all of it is with 75 people, it made the work seem really light. And, if we have a setup crew and we have a number of people, then the work seems pretty light. If, we have 7 people that are signed up as of this morning, if that's all we have, then the work's going to be kind of heavy. So we hope to have enough people to rotate others through. There's people that'll be like, oh, I'm going to be there. I'm like, but please sign up, because at least gives us some names to work with and all that kind of stuff. So if you're thinking about it, let us know. That would be great, because I think you'll enjoy it. At times, it's like, oh, I got to go there early to set up. But when you get there, most people enjoy it, because you're just with people, you're talking, and it's just kind of a low-stress time just to hang out with other believers. So I encourage you to be part of that if you can. The other thing we need is money. So, I'll throw that out there. And it's one of those things that as churches, like, oh, I got to talk about money. And honestly, I've struggled in the past because I don't want church to be about money. I think it kind of gets a bad rap that way. But let's be honest at the same time that Jesus talked about money, and he said things like, where your money is, that's where your heart is. And that can hit pretty hard at times. But, we got to look at what the Lord wants to do. And a new building, we started doing some things, and I do things the Ryan way, and I've told the leaders even this way. I was like, man, if we could just buy property and build a building Ryan's way, we could do it pretty cheap, but can't do it Ryan's way, So, just a tent with some porta potties isn't going to work. So, no, it'd be a little more than that. Trust me, it'd be more than that. So there's the city way, and there's the county way, and there's, the legal way. And so so we got to do things that way. And it definitely makes things a little bit more expensive, which is good, because you end up with a better product in the end, right? So looking at property and just the going rate of building commercial building, just to build the bare minimum. If we were to build something on a bare property with buying the property, you're looking at like $4 million, which I'm like, ugh, that's a lot of money, right? And for some it is. For others, like, yeah, that's just what it costs. I'm like, okay, well, that's cool. Well, you're going to trust God. Well, with that, we also look at, well, God can provide a building too. And so we've been looking at that, and we're looking at, buildings that just like this, were ones that we could buy, and we could go in, and we could repurpose. And so those are things that we're looking at. And so we're actively looking at buildings that are already built, buildings that we could go in and buy that are already in place. And so that's something that we're also just thinking about and working through. And so you could be praying for all of that. So I throw that out there. I put that out there. If one, obviously to buy something, you need money. To build something, you need money. So we need buying power if we're going to buy, or we'd have to raise money to build and all that kind of stuff. And so be praying for that. I'm praying, I'll share this with you. I'm praying for at least for a down payment or a number to shoot for right now. I'm praying for $1 million, which sounds like a lot. And at first I was like, that is a lot. And now I'm like, but I mean, God can do that. And God can bless our socks off. And he's like, maybe you need a little bit more than that. You just don't know it yet. I don't know. But he can do that kind of stuff. But you have to trust him with that, right? And so you put it out there, you see what God's going to do. And so maybe you could be praying along with me. And again, those are things that I don't have answers for. I wish I could be like, here's a building, and this is what we're going to go for. We've looked at a few different things. It would be great. I think that's where we just wait for God to provide. You know, here's some funds, here's a building. It's a match made in heaven, and that's what we look for. So we're looking for things that make sense. Monthly income would have to go up as well if we're going to take on a loan and do that kind of stuff. And so those are just things you can be thinking about, praying, and just laying before the Lord. We need more faith. I need more faith. Faith to step out, faith to give, faith to grow, and make a bigger impact for Jesus. So let me ask you this question kind of in closing. What if we could see 2 people saved and baptized per month this next year on average? Last year we saw the most... We've had an involved church. I think we baptized 8 or 10 people, somewhere in there, which was good. That was really good, and making declaration of faith and all of that. What if you could bump that up? What if God put a young believer in your life so you could mentor them and help them grow? What if God took a young person and kept them from following the ways of this world, and you were part of that? And there's a lot of questions like that. The cool part is there's already the answers. God is already doing that. He's doing that in the life of Evolve Church. And some of the cool things, our church, while, you know, I'll tell you, over the years, I've heard people talk about me. I've heard people even talk about maybe my preaching and comparing it to other people. And I've heard people say things like, well, it seems like you just don't go as deep. And it's hard, obviously, not to get defensive or offended by that way. But here's what I've come to realize. This church, Involved Church, is a church of great faith. And while you may not, I don't know, may not win any awards when it comes to theological vocabulary, it has great faith. And I'd rather be known as a church of great faith than ones that could pass a test on vocabulary. The depth of faith in this church is amazing. And it's one that I can have confidence that, hey, we can make this kind of move and know that it's going to be all right because we trust in God. So praise God for that, right? And let's move forward. Let's walk forward. Let's trust him with these things. Let's continue to put ourselves under him and see what he's going to do, all right? Father, thank you for this day that we can come and we can celebrate and worship you. And it's such a blessing to know that you're in charge. We're your children, and you love us more than the birds of the air and the flowers of the field, and you take care of us. You've been faithful for so many years. You'll continue to be faithful, and we know that. We trust that. And so I pray for the days ahead, for this week. We move into Good Friday, Easter, and the celebration of Jesus Christ. It's a new beginning for us in a lot of different ways, but it goes back to the fact that we have a new life in you. We've been born again. What a joy that is. To trust in you. And so we look forward to what you're going to do with us in the future. Involve church in how we can make an impact here in the life of this church. Thank you for all you've done. You've blessed us in so many ways, and we give you praise, honor, and glory for it. I pray as we sing these songs to you that you'd receive them as a time of worship. In Jesus' name, amen.
Go ahead and stand with us. verse 12. He entered the most holy place once for all time, not by the blood of goats and calves, but by his own blood, having obtained eternal redemption. For if the blood of goats and bulls and the ashes of a young cow, sprinkling those who are defiled, sanctify for the purification of the flesh, how much more will the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without blemish to God, cleanse our consciences from dead works so that we can serve the living God? Therefore, he is the mediator of a new covenant, so that those who are called might receive the promise of the eternal inheritance, because a death has taken place for redemption from the transgressions committed under the first covenant.
Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Plunge me to victory. Beneath the cleansing flood.
Well, thank you for worshiping with us. And I just want to put a shout out. Make sure you grab some of those Easter cards, because that's what we're going to celebrate next week, is the victory we have in Jesus. And so make sure you're inviting people to that. It has been great to worship with you guys. Let's close in a word of prayer and we'll be on for our week. Dear God, again, we thank you for who you are. We thank you for what you have done and what your son did on the cross, dying for our sins. God, what an amazing thing that is, and the victory that we can have in it. God, I just pray as a church, as we enter in this next season of ministry, whatever it may bring, God, that we would constantly come back to you, who you are. We just ask for wisdom and direction. God, lead us in where you would have us. God, let us be bold to share our faith, share the gospel, and through that we would see salvations, we would see baptisms, we would see lives being changed for you. And we want to see that, God, and just be a part of that in your plan. So, God, I just ask a blessing on this week. Take us from this place safely. Bring us back next week to Sherman, where we can once again worship you together. In your name, amen. Have a blessed week, everyone.
Fear's got me living with the lights out, chained down like a prisoner in my own house. Shame cycles like a deadly medication. I try, but I can't change my situation.